Bismillahi walhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Before I share some of the thoughts and comments that I wanted to share here tonight, there's just two things that I wanted to make a specific mention of. First and foremost, as Sister Zahra mentioned about investing into female scholarship and investing into the young people to produce the future scholars and leaders of our communities, alhamdulillah, Southern California is blessed with an institution that has been doing that for 25 years in the Institute of Knowledge. And it's a real gem and a resource that you have here in your community. And I hope and pray that inshallah everyone continues to benefit from this remarkable institution. Secondly, I also wanted to take a moment to acknowledge and appreciate this event here tonight. I've already shared these comments with my friends and colleagues who I've been sitting with here tonight. I shared this with the CAIR-LA leadership and some of the team that put together tonight's event. I'm just absolutely floored and astounded and blown away by the scope of this event and by the turnout of the community, the leadership, the members of the community. This is really truly a testament to the work that CAIR-LA has been doing for 26 years and inshallah will continue doing. Nextly, the reflection that I wanted to share here tonight is that one of the landmark moments of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and a moment, an occasion that has been immortalized within the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this event, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this moment in such a powerful way. And to set the stage and to help you understand exactly what transpired at this occasion in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, very quickly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the age of 40, when he received revelation, Iqra, in the cave of Hira, and he started preaching and teaching the message of Islam, for the next 19 years, for the first 13 years, he preached and taught the message in Mecca, dealing with oppression and persecution and violence and exile of the community members. After that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided them the safe haven of Al-Madinatul Munawwara. They performed the hijrah, the migration from Mecca to Medina. For the next 6 years, they toiled and struggled, but they were still dealing with this enemy that was constantly attacking them, this onslaught of violence against them in the city of Medina. After 6 years, the Prophet ﷺ and the Muslims, they undertook a journey, a peaceful journey, while assuming the state of Ihram, the sacred state in which we go and we perform Hajj and Umrah. And they wanted to go and peacefully offer worship at the Kaaba, at Al-Masjid Al-Haram, the sacred house of God in Mecca. But they were blocked, they were stopped. And the Meccans said, "We will not let you come, we will not let you enter." At that point in time, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to send someone to negotiate on their behalf. Can we work out an arrangement and understanding so that we are able to come and peacefully worship? And after some deliberation, the Prophet ﷺ sent Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu to go into Mecca, to go into enemy territory and negotiate on behalf of the Muslims. And when he went there to present the case on behalf of the Prophet ﷺ, they heard him out and then they said, "We need to deliberate, we need to discuss this amongst ourselves." And they offered him the opportunity to go and perform tawaf, to go worship at the Kaaba while you wait. Uthman bin Affan in an act, in a demonstration of the ultimate loyalty to the Prophet ﷺ, he refused. And he said, I cannot go there and pray there and perform tawaf and worship without my messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They were so infuriated and insulted by his response that they put him in a room and said, hold him here until we are done deliberating, and then he can take the answer back. But so he was removed, nobody saw him. And as oftentimes the case is, when a rumor spreads, that rumor morphs and changes as it moves from person to person. The news reached back to the Prophet ﷺ that Uthman has been killed. Uthman has been murdered. And that was such an offense to the Prophet ﷺ. That was so outrageous. That was so outrageous of an act. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went and he sat down under the shade of a tree at a place where there was a well where the Muslims had camped out, and that place is called Al-Hudaybiyah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat down under the shade of a tree. There were 1400 Muslims, and all 1400 of them lined up. And one by one by one by one, they came forth, they put their hand in the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and took an oath of allegiance. And they swore that they would defend the life and the honor of Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu. That even if they had to give their lives, they had to give up their own lives, but they would ensure that justice was achieved for their brother Uthman. And the Prophet ﷺ took the oath of allegiance from all 1400. At the end, he concluded by putting one hand in the other hand, and he said that this is for Uthman. And as soon as they were done with this process, they saw an envoy approaching from the distance, and they saw that Uthman was with them. And they rejoiced to see that Uthman was still alive, and he was okay. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse of the Quran, لَقَدَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. God indeed is pleased with the believers. إِذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ. When they swore the oath of allegiance to you, O Muhammad, under the shade of the tree. فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. And Allah knew what was in their hearts, that they were true, they were sincere, they were loyal and they were devout, that they would not let their brother's life go, his blood be spilled in vain. وَأَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ عَلَيْهِمْ. And Allah descended His tranquility upon them. وَأَثَابَهُمْ فَتْحًا قَرِيبًا. And Allah promised them a very close victory. I bring up this occasion, this landmark moment from the life of the Prophet ﷺ, because if you think about the underlying theme, the idea, it was about the value of every single Muslim life. It was about the significance and the preservation of the life, the honor, the dignity, the property of each and every single Muslim without discrimination. And this is our religion. These are the values that we hold firm to. This is what we believe, and from what I've seen here tonight, this is what we practice. That we hold the life, the dignity, the honor, the property of each and every single Muslim in the highest regard. And this is our duty, this is our responsibility. And one thing that I reflect upon quite often for myself, I'm going to share something personal with you. I oftentimes think about this, that there are these responsibilities that we have. By virtue of being believers, by virtue of saying La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, we are encumbered with certain responsibilities. This is a great blessing. Alhamdulillahi ala ni'matil Islam. It is the greatest blessing. But the greater the blessing, the greater the responsibility. But I oftentimes think about the fact that I personally am not doing anything in regards to those responsibilities. I personally am not fulfilling and discharging those responsibilities. But the blessing of our ummah, our collective community, innamal mu'minuna ikhwa, inna hadhihi ummatukum ummatan wahida. The blessing of us being an ummah is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises up amongst us people, individuals, brothers and sisters, who assume that responsibility on behalf of all of us. Make no mistake, when one Muslim is detained unjustly, incorrectly, when one Muslim's rights are being violated, when one Muslim's honor is being trampled upon, when one Muslim's family is being persecuted, it is on all of our collective shoulders. It is my job and my responsibility to do something about that. But I'm not. And I don't say that in a defiant way, I say that in a very remorseful and regretful and honestly sad way that I'm not doing anything about it. But what I can do, what many of y'all have done here tonight, and I encourage all of us to do more, is to support the people that are doing that work. To support them and help them however we can. They are asking us for the easiest, simplest way that we can help and we can contribute, is that is through our financial resources. And I understand that that's, you know, money is not, you know, it doesn't grow on trees, etc. But think about your time, your energy, your ability. And they're asking us to write a check. They're asking us to donate and contribute, to take care of this responsibility on behalf of all of us. That's the least we can do. My time is up, and there's been a number of stories shared here tonight. Obviously, Ambassador Ibrahim and his story of his, you know, being a political prisoner. Sheikh Ahmed shared his struggles in terms of travel and being singled out for being a Muslim. I dealt with two very, very difficult years, where every single time I entered back into the country, if I traveled internationally, I was detained for a minimum of 6 hours. Every single time. And unfortunately, I do travel quite a bit and I get invited sometimes to speak at different conferences. There was one occasion where I was invited to a conference in Canada. I went there for a day, came back, and then the next weekend I was invited to another conference somewhere else in Canada, and I went there and I came back, and both times I was detained for 8 hours. It became so unnerving. I even traveled with my family. I had my 18-month-old son, and they detained us for 8 hours and just kept us there. And it got so bad that I still remember the moment a year and a half into this ordeal where I did not go for Umrah. And I remember how heartbreaking it was for me that I was supposed to go perform Umrah to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I did not go because of just how difficult it was to deal with that. And it's my ignorance, once again, I was just kind of enduring this, thinking there was no way out from this, until one of the brothers who's involved with CAIR was visiting us in Dallas, and he came by the Qalam campus, and one of my colleagues ended up saying that, you know, AbdelNasir has this little bit of a situation going on, and he's like, why didn't you tell us? I said, tell you what? He said, tell us what's going on. So what are you going to do about it? He said, this is what we do. This is what we do. He said it funny. He said, we sue the government for a living, right? This is what we do. And subhanAllah, they got on the phone with me. They requested all these, you know, details, when did you fly, the dates, and all the different trips you took, and how long were you detained, on what days. And I gave them all the information. And basically they said that they received some kind of a response saying that, you know, no, he's not on any list that we have, et cetera, et cetera. Brother Hussam can probably explain to you what that's about. But the next opportunity was that I was going for Umrah with my wife. And we went for Umrah, we had a beautiful trip, alhamdulillah. And then when we were flying back in, I was like holding my breath from like 2 hours before we landed. I felt I couldn't breathe because I knew what I was in for, or what I thought I was in for. And we landed and I went up to the kiosk and, you know, it prints out that little slip. And I was so used to seeing an X on my face, that's what I thought I looked like. And when that slip printed out and there was no X on my face, I'm from Texas and so we're kind of like rowdy. I started being like, yeah, all right. You know, I started celebrating in the middle of the airport. And she said, now they're going to pull you over, right? Because you're causing a ruckus in the airport. And I was like, you know, celebrating, and I was so happy, alhamdulillah. And alhamdulillah, I walked through, and since that point on forward, I've never been pulled over or stopped for any kind of detention or screening again. And this is one of the tens of thousands of stories all across this country that CARE has made possible. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your efforts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless this work that you do. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you the steadfastness to continue. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum.